You're late.
Yeah.
Chester, close it.
Trying to be helpful.
I did, I was trying, it was.
You remember.
You were damaging county property with that lever.
With the plastic.
I wanted to fix it.
With our rubber doors on. It's all computerized.
Thanks.
Remember her lawsuit?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
With the beef association when that occurred?
I do remember that.
That's where Dr. Phil came from, because he was her psychiatrist. She was so depressed, she said, I like you, then so good for me, I'm gonna put you on TV.
Is the door propped open?
But I bet you she doesn't say anything about the red slime.
So it's like Chick-fil-A. We'll ask about that if that.
Yeah, I don't want to add it to the agenda.
No, then it's not ours, then. I think that would be like extra.
They'll come in.
The computer says it's 6:30. So then that's an extra chair out there.
That's an extra one, yeah, yeah.
Good. And then there's another one on side of Tom if Matt doesn't.
A new garden.
Thank you.
Anybody here from Matt?
They're putting out for the kids. And.
It's Matt.
Just in case anyone else shows up.
Who's Matt?
The new one, somebody can talk about the bees and relationship with the gardens and all.
I got contacts. Should we put it up here and just get a wide scope? Scope? That's not the word, is it? Oh, you mean, but if it was just. You never.
So much. The size is that good distance.
Nothing could make this boring.
I didn't know that until I went and got checked.
The camera effects help.
But I just thought it was wrong.
Wow. Paraplegics or something.
Have you heard anything?
No messages.
Have you heard anything about them looking into the National Barbecue Club?
Are we ready?
Wait, wait, you're not ready.
I'd like to call the meeting to order. Is there a motion to adopt the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. Number one, adoption of resolution of appreciation for Jim Kelleher.
Do you say anything to add on that?
No, there were two, you know, there's two copies. One that's in the form of presentation and then one that will go in the minute book. So.
And he's going to try to be here.
Yes, I will confirm that, but he did say he put it on his calendar. So when y'all are signing the minutes, if you will sign that first and then get it back to me because I got to read it.
Read it, yeah.
And then there'll be one for him to present to him. So if you will sign that one first and then I can get it back.
Okay. And there's no action on that. That's just an announcement. Number two, review and discussion of unified development code changes. Okay. A?
A is the one of the carryover items we had from last month. It's the one we had the majority of comments on during the public hearing. The 30-second refresher or you were here last time. That was your first meeting.
Yeah.
Currently, as the UDC is drafted, bees fall under the definition of livestock. That doesn't strike a lot of people as the way it should be.
I got a question.
Yes.
Why are we discussing bees tonight?
Because we're having a public hearing on it next week.
Didn't we have a public hearing last week?
Month.
Last month.
Do you have the motion, Teresa, that I thought they postponed?
Yeah, can you read them?
We postponed.
Who decided to postpone that meeting?
We did.
It was Matt Murphy.
But we seconded and everybody.
I don't care. Matt Murphy postponed that meeting. Where is Matt Murphy? That's all I got to say.
Okay.
We postponed that. We're discussing this because Matt Murphy wanted to postpone it. We very easily could have gone right on through with it, saved a lot of people a lot of time. But Matt Murphy, I don't want to hear from you right now. I'm talking. You're interrupting me.
I would have postponed it.
Oh, you're interrupting me too. Matt Murphy.
Because I thought it was necessary that it be postponed.
But the fact of the matter is, he postponed it, and he doesn't even have enough respect for our committee to show up. And he is the one that made the remark. That's all I'm going to say. If horses had wings, they'd fly. You know? If.
Carry on, Tom.
Go ahead, Tom.
Because I think I'm interested in hearing, and I would have postponed it anyway, because I think there were questions. There were a lot of questions.
Sorry about that.
Thank you. The current definition of livestock captures bees. Based on that, beekeeping is prohibited in most residential zoning districts. The change before you, which came as a suggestion from our elected officials, would allow beekeeping in every zoning district in the county, not just residential districts. You heard the discussion at last month's public hearing, the questions back and forth about where it should be allowed, should there be any kinds of restrictions on it. I told you a month ago, and you followed that advice. I appreciate it. Of just keep in mind, if we do try to put restrictions, make sure it's something I can send a code enforcement officer out to enforce. Bees per acre, I can't enforce. Maybe there are other things you think are appropriate that we could, and come next week, if you propose some, we'll try to be ready to give you any input on if you think it's something we can follow up on or not.
Thank you. Pam, I know you've done a lot of research in the last month on bees. You've even gone out and you've witnessed a beehive in action. Do you have anything to add?
Well, I had Tom send me a list of what he could impose and what he couldn't, I guess, a while back. And I still think that they should be allowed in all residential districts. But I do think that we need to put something in the code, in that chart where it says apiary. And here's my question about that. Do we then need a definition of apiary in the definition section?
Well, it wouldn't hurt.
Yeah, do other than bee people know what apiary is?
Well, people that know would be looking it up in the first place, most likely.
Most likely would. Well, you all are the planners, and that's up to you whether that's necessary or not.
Well, I will make a note on that and chew on that for the next week.
But if there was some way in the chart where apiaries now, you know, if we pass this, would be listed in all districts, if you could put C note. You know, on some of them, there's a note about following the best bee practices. I just don't want us to be in the bee enforcement business. And I think that people, when they have a complaint, if they have a complaint, need to call the Extension Service, not the Department of Planning and Development. And I don't know that we can put anything like that in the UDC because I just think we can't. I don't know how you get that across except if people call.
I've got the solution right here. And I had planned on making this, like y'all had planned on making the motion, I had planned on making this the motion last time myself, but I got cut out. And it's wasting a lot of taxpayers' dollars. And y'all would have wasted taxpayers' dollars by us having to revisit this. But I think I want to read this to you and see what you think about it. I'd like to make a motion that we change the UDC in order to permit apiaries in all zoning districts. Is that what you just said?
Yeah.
and listen, in all zoning districts, in all zoning districts in Forsyth County, and that we recommend beekeepers adhere to the best beekeeping practices established by the Forsyth County beekeepers. Is anybody from Forsyth County beekeepers here tonight?
Ribs.
Do y'all have a best practices policy? We can ask them to talk with the Beekeepers Association. If they talk to the Beekeepers Association and they're not happy, then they can go to court.
Well, that was my question to Tom, though, is I don't know if anything like that can be enforced. So is it necessary to put it in there or not?
I think the intention is that we don't enforce it.
Yeah,
the intention is that, my take on Jody's suggestion is it's just, it's there as a courtesy suggestion to say, hey, think about this document, and we think it would be a good idea if you complied with it, but it's clear we're not attempting to enforce it.
So you can put it in the charts, like, see note. I don't remember what those notes are, but
you refer them to the best management practices.
There is, and there's a lot of...
This is exactly what Pam was saying.
On a different level, you see...
And I would have made the motion if I had not been prevented from doing it last week.
Well, that's all these people a lot of time.
But we didn't have this last week.
You already see that some in the UDC in the difference between should and shall. When you read through some sections, it says shall, it's something you're going to have to do and we're going to enforce. And when it says should, saying we're encouraging you to do this, but if you don't, there's nothing we're going to tell you. Just flat out, you have to do it. So yeah, if that's what the Planning Commission wants at the close of next week's hearing, I'm comfortable with that.
Okay.
All right, anything else about
these? Is that something that since I'm proposing that y'all were going to vote against? I never get a second.
Jody, just do your business. That's all you need to do.
You do yours too, okay?
That's what I'm doing.
Okay.
Exactly. B, Chapter 3, modifications to definition of church.
Nothing new to add. County attorney confirmed there was no issue with that definition as he drafted it. And I don't have anything to add to it other than we postponed it. I think he also answered the question that came up about a change of use in a structure that Pam had asked. Paul Fritton,
well, the word worship instead of church, place of worship, is what I think is much more appropriate than the word mm-hmm. church anyway, because it's a place of worship. Every different place of worship is not called a church.
Right.
But what
so
happens,
I don't know why we're even calling it a church at
me,
all.
I agree with you.
Period.
But I think I think it ought to be called, because if it's a place of worship, what if you decide to play basketball there? Religious institution is that covers mosques, temples, churches, whatever. I think. But, you know, if you want to
place of worship, same thing. I mean, you can play basketball at a religious institution, too. But the primary focus is on worship. I think we're a little bit behind the time by defining it as church. Because a mosque is not a church. A synagogue, they don't call a church. It's a synagogue.
I agree.
I don't know what the Seventh Advents call their, you know, the Mormons, I don't know what they call
it. A hall.
Temple.
Okay, a temple or a hall. So I think we're behind the times. I think we need to step up and present it what it is.
I just personally like the name religious facility. If it makes y'all happy, that is not a name I came up with. That was a name that was given to me by somebody else, so I'm just parroting it, you know. And I just think that religious facility, that would be more of what we do, which is a building, than a place of worship. you know, when you get into the worship part, then we're not zoning worshiping. You know, but a religious facility, we can zone that. And I'm not, your concept, and I'm in total agreement with.
And I guess my splitting hairs would be, what does the word religion, what is the definition for that? I mean, does that split down? I mean, do, you know, do other sects not call themselves religion, but they still worship something?
True. And the benefit also that we realized this week or last week was that in the parking chapter and in some other chapters, when you cross-reference, it is called place of worship. So that would save a lot of time.
Exactly. It's already there.
It's already in there. So that, yeah, and we just.
It would just make it easier.
I just picked up on that last week.
Okay.
In the parking.
If that's the case.
And I think we're talking the same thing.
No, we are. That's what I said.
I mean, it's just not a church, and I think we need to step up to the plate and make that change.
I'm in total agreement.
Okay, so that's that.
All right, any other discussion on church?
And then we're going to leave the definition as what Tom has it drawn up. I mean, of course, we're going to decide next week, but it's your.
Was there a discussion on that?
Can you read what we have? What you got there?
The way it is now or the new one?
Yeah, can you do both the way that it is now and what's proposed as the change?
Right. You're striking through the words that by design and construction are primarily intended. So you're getting rid of some fairly loose language.
So the proposal is a building or structure or groups of buildings or structures used for conducting organized religious services.
Instead of by design or
intended.
Intended.
Instead of, it adds use rather than saying by design and construction.
Used for what?
Used for conducting organized religious services.
So that cuts out ping pong, basketball.
But that's primary, right?
Accessory.
I mean, I'm not trying to be hard about it.
Well, no, but they all do have gymnasiums.
What does it cut out?
Most churches do.
It cuts out a building whose primary use is ping pong.
Oh.
Yes.
But it doesn't.
Okay, well, how about, okay, and I'm just looking at, I know the Baptist church downtown here. It's got a building that's primarily an activity building. It's not primarily used for worship. How is that going to be affected?
Well, that's approved by a conditional use permit secondary to the primary use of the church anyway. That has to be approved by the board commission. You build your worship, your center first, yeah. Your structure, where you worship.
Yeah. In a lot of places,
anything
it's the same thing.
I'm just trying to make sure we get it right.
It's approved by the Board of Commissioners through a conditional use permit.
It's a lot of it comes down, and this isn't unique to churches. It's any use we attempt to identify in our ordinance. There are sometimes these incidental uses that go along with it, and it comes down to this department making a call on if they think that's appropriate or not. And if you have concerns with it, I've no problem whatsoever with you if the overall drive is to add more detail to that.
Can I read y'all something here? Because I did a little research on this myself, like Pam did with the beat. Did y'all do any research on the churches?
Yeah.
What did y'all come up with?
Well, I mean, the one thing, the definition of church, I wasn't real comfortable with continuing with that. I think there's some discussion on, you know, what it eliminates and what it doesn't. And I want to be real careful that we're not eliminating things that we don't intend on eliminating.
How does this sound to you all? we're going to call it place of worship would be a building together with its accessory buildings and use where persons regularly assemble for religious purposes and related social events, and which building, together with its accessory buildings and uses, is maintained and controlled by a religious body organization organized to sustain religious ceremonies and purposes. That comes from Plymouth, Minnesota. That's their, that came out of their book. And I think that's a, I think that touches most all the bases without being, would y'all like to see, read that?
Well, Tom, what do you?
Here, here, it's right here, it's in the green.
On, yeah, I heard what you read. On first take, that, that sounds like, nothing jumps out at me as being a problem with that.
So that's still, if the primary business is worship, that's what, so it doesn't, I mean, just because you're doing basketball or whatever, that's just an accessory to the place of worship, correct? Mm-hmm. Which is fine, because, I mean, like, Creekside Methodist, 141, their place of worship is their basketball court. Yeah. And a lot of places are.
I don't think you're ever going to get, and I'm confident, you're never going to get this definition where it just spells out everything a church can do or can't do. Mm-hmm. Even like this one, this adds some wording, and on first take, I think it's a good addition. But it says, you know, now we're talking about related social events. Well, that gives us a little more idea, but there's still no list that tells me what a related social event is. And at the end of the day, I still have to sit there and decide.
Mm-hmm.
And no matter what, I think the definition you're going to come up with is always going to be at some point.
But this would cover them, and they wouldn't have to have as an accessory. You wouldn't have to have a another zoning added, correct? As long as it wasn't another building. If it was another building, you would.
But I don't see that changing much from the definition that's in your books either. I'm gonna sign off on accessory uses, and it comes down to we just have to make a call. Does it seem reasonable?
Well, I kind of like that one. I mean, not because I found it, it's just because I think it covers, it takes away some doubt that with people. And it sounds like Pam is coming along on that too, which I'll take my hat off to.
Well, I don't think we were apart on any of these issues. We're just trying to do the right thing, that's all.
You're right. Okay.
Jordan, if you would, can I have a copy of that?
You can have this.
We will
maybe, yeah, make a copy, I guess.
I'll make a copy. We will,
because I may want to make a motion. I mean, but I may.
We'll make a look. We'll take,
you know,
a look.
I may come up with something different.
We'll next time. Week, we'll look at it.
Would you be able to email that to us sometime this week, just that we could see it?
Why don't we just make some,
or copy? Could you just make copies?
Yeah.
Well, and we can email it out to everybody,
just
as well as the county attorney.
If within the next week, if we have any questions, right. Yeah, and you have to have the county attorney look at it anyway.
Yeah. It's not that hard to retype it.
Yeah, and all I want to do is just make sure it doesn't interfere with these places that are, you know, in other buildings, but that are churches and in-home use for Bible studies, and I mean, all of that kind of stuff. I want
to
make sure all those people are clear.
You said you had three on that page.
Just the middle.
And is that true, Tom? I mean, people that have, I mean, I know tons of women that have Bible study groups in their houses. It's not going to crack down on anything like that, is it?
Well, I think you got to get to the point of saying.
Well, it's.
It's how it's written. You're going to need to look at how it's written and make that decision.
I don't have any intention
of doing that.
Right, but I want to make sure the way it's written,
you
that that's not.
You write that in there. Someone else in this job in the future could read it differently. So if that's a concern, I suggest you build that kind of stuff in the definition.
But then if you do that, if you do that, it's possible that almost anybody can say that their house is a religious, is a place of worship. You know, if you start putting a house in.
That they do not fall under this description is what I'm saying.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well,
not that they do. That,
well,
they do not.
They're not spelled out here.
This definition would go a little further in saying
it's maintaining
control. Maintained and controlled by a religious body.
Yeah, that's the main part, too. It's maintained.
Yeah.
Yeah, that, Tom is right, Pam. It says, the reason you wouldn't need to put anything about that is because it would say the building is controlled by the religious body.
Primary use, and a house primary use would not be Bible study.
And it's not controlled by the religious body.
And that's fine. I just want to make sure that there's...
Do y'all kind of like that, from what I'm hearing?
So far, I don't have a problem. Ken Drawer needs to look at it and tell us if he has a problem.
Okay.
I mean, if this is coming out of a municipality, hopefully they did their litmus test on this.
Yeah. Well, I would like to give credit where credit's due on this, if I may, since it does seem to be the satisfactory. Do you have any problems with this? This came from Sharon. And I'd like to thank her for coming up with this. I think it was a job well done. It touches all the bases. That's what you do, isn't it?
It was just samples off the ones.
But it's...
Well, that's good. That's what we want. But I want to give credit
where credit's due. This is not... I'm presenting it. And Sharon found it. Thank you. I think it's... It looks like it was kind of got a consensus for everybody.
Well, I think it covers everything that I was concerned about.
So, thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions about church? C, chapter 16, modifications to accessory structure regulations.
There's a lot of strike through and underline in this, starting on page 16-10, much of it is moving the code around, make it a little bit easier for staff use. The main objective is the F and G, and this is to address how one attaches an accessory building to the principal building, so it is considered part of the principal building because it's based on size and other limitations we have in the code. We have had some instances where people have attempted to attach their accessory structure to the primary structure for the purposes of it being all one primary structure. So we've been kind of struggling with
what's wrong with that?
It's basically not part of the primary structure, and we have limitations, 1,000 square feet and larger, based on your zoning. It's not applicable in agricultural zoning. It's in residential districts based on the size of your lot. So we've had some Butler buildings and some really massive buildings constructed a few times without a permit, and then they try to attach it with whatever means they can to have it considered part of the primary. But
someone could go through the appeal process.
Yes.
And have that.
Yes. But what we came up with was F and G, that if they are going to attach it, there's a limitation. The 6 feet in width and 8 feet in height is in basically related to the building code, but that it be a maximum of 16 feet in length. And when we presented that to the Board of Commissioners, they were a little concerned that you may have a unique, really large home that could have a hallway that long or even longer, and that we would be telling people how they could design their homes, which we didn't want to get into that. So that's where we add that if it comes in together and you can tell it's an architectural design, that we can sign off on some, it would be exempt from the 16 feet in length.
So it's part of the original
permit.
So if there's like an original house and they're building a new house and they're connecting, and the reason I'm saying this is because a friend of mine did this in Fulton County.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah.
But they did. They put it, and it's longer than 16 feet.
Right.
But it's all enclosed in a patio and pool area and everything. But it's, you know, it's gorgeous.
And in our first couple of drafts, we were so focused on what to do with this hallway and how do we, you know, deal with the hallway that we weren't really thinking that, you know, with some architects, you know, that's not that big a deal.
Yeah.
That's
exactly what they did, because they took
the
original house, the new house, and they put this to connect the two.
So hopefully this will work.
It's a breezeway.
We had in the last couple of years this hasn't been real frequent. It's come up twice in the last couple of years. And Board of Commissioners proposed this, they didn't propose 16 feet, they proposed that we modify the code to end the ability to use these long hallways to connect buildings. So that's where it came from. I think they were concerned that they have these limitations on accessory structures, on the size, and that they had just recently seen two examples where people were able to get around that limitation by using the hallway. That's where it came from.
As an afterthought.
Mm-hmm. In the two examples, yeah, it was both an afterthought, yeah.
I remember. Any other comments, questions?
Well, if somebody wants to do this, can they come in and go through the, make an appeal to do it?
A variance, right?
A variance, yes. It would be.
And then if this is part of your plan in the very beginning, can they do it?
Yes.
Without
a variance.
So even longer than 16 feet. It's part of the original plan.
Right.
Okay.
So there is a process then afterwards.
Yes.
Any other questions, concerns? D, chapter 9 and 21, amendment for new design overlay district.
The reference to chapter 9 is to simply add the name of the overlay districts to establishment of overlay districts. That's housekeeping. But basically, back in November, Commissioner Levent requested that we take a look at his area and consider some overlays in the 9 McFarland area that, you know, he knew things were going to pick up, but he'd like, you know, little upgrades, and he wanted the Peachtree Parkway extended. So Peachtree Parkway, which is 21-8, which is page 1, basically extended up through Bethelview all the way to Kelly Mill Road.
And it does not include the Castleberry overlay, correct? It's to it and then after.
Correct, because that's real site-specific.
Yeah, exactly, and it shouldn't anything to do with that.
So we're taking, if approved, taking the Peachtree Parkway overlay up to Kelly Mill. And that was pretty...
All the setbacks and everything, the same as 141?
The setbacks aren't really different than commercial. It's more the architectural and landscaping isn't as tough, but it's mostly the architectural, the cornices and the screening and a public space. And
because it's primarily residential up through there.
Right.
It's not commercial.
Right. So it won't affect that which is residential, but anything coming
only
in commercial.
Yes.
No. From 141 to Kelly Mill, there's a good bit of commercial in there, Pam. You got.
But there's a lot of subdivisions.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Polo subdivision.
I mean, there.
No. They're we're back this side.
No, it's Polo.
Okay.
Yeah, Polo. There's all sorts of stuff. There's Creekside. I mean, it goes.
There's a couple of big vacant parcels.
Like the old steeplechase.
Here.
Do agree
big ones.
From 9 to the Bethelview overlay, you have more non-residential uses. From the Bethelview overlay to Kelly Mill, you have more non-commercial uses.
More residential.
Yeah, you've got that whole corner.
I just wanted to make sure that they didn't get penalized, and then still have the character of residential up through there. Which is going to, I mean, it'll be a mix. And that's kind of your area, so any comments or anything?
Without, you know, if it's not going to affect the residential, I don't see what's the problem.
Affect just a recreational track. I think we've had one or two rec tracks come through that they had to do a little more landscaping and some of the architectural stuff.
So will you incorporate that in your presentation next week about how it will not relate to residential?
Sure.
And then we can hit it right in the presentation and hopefully answer a couple of concerns from the audience before we even hear them.
Okay.
Thank you.
And then what is completely new overlay starting on page 2 is on your map, it's the, basically the blue stripe, which is Atlanta, McFarland, and Mullinax. And it started off with strictly the fencing and the landscaping, but then we talked about, you know, some economic incentives. Basically, the nine area, it needs some growth, and the McFarland Mullinax, it's certainly coming. So what we did is, other than the district delineation, we added landscaping and some flexibility in parking, the board fences, the architectural building materials, and if I'm moving too fast, I don't know if you have any specific questions.
Is Mullinax ever slated to be formed?
I believe it is.
And how soon is that? Because that's key
yeah.
to that whole area.
I can answer that question tomorrow night.
Or next week.
I mean, yeah, next week.
Yeah, because there's probably going to be people yeah. interested in knowing that.
And that was part of the district commissioner's reasoning was that, you know, we're four-laning, now's the time. Even though things are slow now, it's going to pick up and let's have this on the books. So we wanted kind of a carrot and a stick overlay that, you know, you're going to do the landscaping and some extra open space, but for that we're going to have flexible parking that you can decide based on your franchise and your marketing studies, your parking. So what we have is a minimum and a maximum for the parking. And then the architectural building materials is pretty straightforward. We have a 70% and a 30%, 30% with accent, 70% for brick and stone, which under the current commercial, it's really 100%. And then we work with people, and sometimes that kind of slows the process down, trying to work that out.
And what's the appeal process going to be for the overlay?
We have the alternative design review criteria application, where basically they'll go to the Board of Commissioners if there's a change. Like, I know you folks dealt with the American the Sports Academy.
Academies,
but this is not going to be as restrictive as Peachtree. Peachtree is a lot more restrictive. This is just
more redesign, redevelopment.
It's redevelopment, but nail it down.
Encouraging them.
Right, and it also will be easier on staff, because now that we've worked with the Peachtree as well as the big box.
You see where there's changes.
And it's difficult to either interpret or enforce, or their handicaps.
And will there be changes to the Peachtree overlay?
For this round, we're not proposing any Peachtree. I don't think anyone really wanted to open up that language, other than we're going to take it farther north.
Because I'm already hearing there may need to be some changes on it.
Right. Not next week.
I got
caught. Please. Slow this one down. So it's, again, the materials, the minimum landscape open space is greater, and the but the setbacks, we have some flexibility in the setbacks, and we have some flexibility in the width of the landscaping. I think one of the greatest issues with the design is the parking flexibility. We spend a lot of time at the staff level with folks trying to work out parking issues. Again, the same language with dumpsters, and a lot of the language that's in Chapter 12 is repeated in this chapter, but so staff as well as a designer doesn't have to hop around from chapter to chapter. We tried to get it in all in the, all in one place. Outdoors. Storage. The canopies is new, but we were kind of concerned. We have, if we do have a lot of info online and gas stations, you see like the one company, Hotspots or whatever it's called, where the canopy gets super high and lighting is, you know, just blinding as far as that. So I don't know if you had any specific questions, but again, this was a request of the district commissioner. We've taken it upstairs a few times, and here are.
As long as you have a way to get people in and out, that's to 400. Any questions, concerns?
I added some of the charts in the back. I don't know if that helped or it was just confusing the existing code. And
is there any language to the maintenance on the fencing?
There is.
Yeah, that's going to be.
Other than, you know, it would be just code enforcement.
Full-time.
That's a full-time job.
Yeah. kind of like the fences on the...
Yeah, I'm not sure if there's language in the castle barrier. I mean, if you want that added, we can bring that up next week.
That should be a concern.
I think there's a property maintenance reference in chapter 10.
A full-time job.
And you know how awful it looks when it's not maintained? It defeats the purpose of putting them up.
They added some sidewalks down on Post Road, and there was nothing in there about maintaining them. The weeds grew over the top. It looked terrible. Sidewalks were nice, but the weeds were never, you know, it's awful, so.
I know there's something about awnings in there. I did some research also on economic incentives, and it was really hard to come up with much. We already do plan review very quickly. We don't have any tax and increment districts that we want to come up with. You know, that's a lot of chamber and economic development stuff, but I think for our first stab here, to start.
Any other questions? Number three, review and discussion regarding pending applications currently in applicants' work time.
I have your list in front of you. Nothing greatly has changed. The tower, I've had a couple of conversations with these guys. I think they may be looking at an alternative site. But
I was
going to
ask you about that.
They haven't presented me with any definite site, but we've had some discussions. But I'll wait till I get an application submitted with an actual site on it. But
is the third party review in yet, or
no?
Because since they're looking for another site,
and they're working with him, I'm, you know, okay. They did. Chip called and asked if, you know, just some technical questions, like if we change sites, what does that do with the current application, mm-hmm. and that kind of thing. So that leads me to believe that there's some action going. And when that happens, they work with Rick on that. And I'm not usually too involved with that until I get another application submitted to Rick, and then we, you know, we go from there. So the other ones, I don't think you probably have any really questions about. If you do, I'll answer.
Any questions? And number four, review and discussion of applications scheduled for public hearings on March 27th, 2012. First one is Happy Dogs Play and Stay, LLC.
This is the reason they're getting a conditional use permit, because they want outdoor runs. They're taking an existing building in an industrial park that was a site for construction. I think it was outdoor construction, lots of trucks and stuff, and they've really cleaned the site up.
Yeah, it looks good. I was out there today.
And so they have to ask for it. They're allowed to go in this use, but the conditional use permit is for them to have outdoor runs.
Right. Any problems, any opposition so far that anyone's heard?
I haven't heard any opposition.
I mean, there are no subdivisions close, right?
Not close enough, yeah. I don't believe. And I mean, the bullseye mark, the shooting range is right there, almost right next door.
Any questions? Next is Charles S.
McGlamory.
McGlamory. Is it GG?
That's an extra G.
Yeah. Nothing. I was going to say.
Sharon noticed that while you were speaking. Nothing, yeah. 3586. This is a LR property on the lake. And this guy has purchased a piece of property that was like two old mobile homes that were, you know, coming down. And he's purchased it, cleaned it up. He wants to build his home there, and his wife possibly wants a horse. So that's the reason he's going to agricultural, because they want to do the white picket fence and she wants...
Well, she can probably get one for free right now.
Yeah, but she couldn't do it in LR.
Left and right.
But she couldn't have one in LR, so that's the reason.
So that she's zoning to agricultural.
From what I understand, all his neighbors are thrilled because he's cleaned the place up. It was a site that had gone unkept for a while.
Any questions? Or any other business? Is there a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. This is what sometimes you get, not very often, but sometimes.
Does it matter to me?
Resolution?
Yeah. I don't feel like doing a resolution. We never read the rules and regulations. Personal thing.
I would imagine that's very rare.
It is. That's not, like, this is one of your frame. It's like John Merritt. I mean, that's always nice.
I don't care about resolution. Minutes are different, I think.
That's what I'm saying. Resolution is different. I think it would be hypocritical to say, hey, you've done a big job when you never even read the rules and regulations.
I think you have to sign them if you don't want to.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening.
You too.